Hi dear students, hope you're fine, keeping safe. Right, let's start with a new system. I hope all of you have done your exam well. Your endocrinology part was over. Now moving on to the cardiovascular system. So like when you talk about cardiovascular system in pharmacology, it includes the renal system also, because you know, like many of these drugs used in or which alter the renal function, especially diuretics, antidiuretics and all, used in various cardiovascular diseases. So when we talk about cardiovascular system, it includes your renal system also, right? Fine. We are starting with your renin-angiotensin system and the drugs which can interfere with the renin-angiotensin system. This is what we are going to discuss, because there are plenty of drugs which can interfere with the renin-angiotensin system and can impart some beneficial effects in the therapeutic context. So this is what we are going to discuss with this topic. All right. I hope all of you know what are the components of renin-angiotensin system. As you know that renin, angiotensinogen, angiotensin 1, angiotensin 2, etc. Apart from this, what is the physiological role of renin-angiotensin system in the body? So all of you are aware that renin-angiotensin system is a long-term way for the regulation of your blood pressure, isn't it? See, there are different ways of regulation of blood pressure, which includes the neuronal ways, where the sympathetic outflow and the vasomotor center and all includes in the nerve or the neuronal way of the blood pressure regulation. Apart from that, we have the endocrine ways. There are plenty of hormones, adrenaline, noradrenaline, thyroid hormones, and many other components of the hormones are involved in the regulation of blood pressure. And the third one is the renal way, where renin-angiotensin system play an important role. So this is what we are going to do in this class. All right. So the renin-angiotensin system. One second. Let me take the pointer. Okay, fine. So the renin-angiotensin system participate in the regulations of blood pressure. I hope you know that. Also involved in the pathophysiology of hypertension. That's very important. Like, see, some of the mutation of the gene coded for the renin-angiotensin system may be renin receptors, angiotensin receptors, renin angiotensin converting enzyme, enzyme gene. So some of the mutation of these components can leads to increased blood pressure, hypertension. So you know that essential hypertension is etiology is unknown. It is idiopathic. Definitely, there's mutation of the gene may play a role. And it also plays, especially the locally synthesized renin-angiotensin system, is responsible for the progression of the heart failure, especially ventricular remodeling. Ventricular remodeling, I'll show you when we talk about the heart failure. So ventricular remodeling is a compensatory mechanism in case of the case of heart failure, which increase the mass of the ventricle mass or the muscles. So there we have learned that we have studied that renin-angiotensin system, especially angiotensin 2, has got significant role, and it can even cause myocardial infarction and diabetic nephropathy. So in addition to the regulation of blood pressure, it is also involved in the pathophysiology of various cardiovascular and non-cardiovascular condition, as we have depicted here: heart failure, congestive cardiac diseases, myocardial infarction, and diabetic nephropathy. So understanding the basic physiology and pathology of renin-angiotensin system is very important as far as the pharmacology is concerned. So this realization has led to a thorough exploration of the renin-angiotensin system and the development of new approaches for inhibiting its actions. You know, various components, which includes right from the beta 1 receptor blockade, because you know beta 1 receptors are located in the juxtaglomerular cells from which the renin is secreted, from where the renin is secreted. So there beta 1 receptor antagonist, renin antagonist, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, angiotensin 2 blockers, and many other components are used. So as I already told you, the components includes renin from it is secreted from the extraglomerular cells in response to various stimuli. We'll be discussing that. Angiotensinogen, angiotensin 1, angiotensin 2 and 3, and angiotensin converting enzyme. And angiotensin 2 can stimulate the secretion of aldosterone from adrenal medulla. Okay, adrenal cortex. I'm sorry, adrenal into angiotensin 1. Okay, angiotensin precursor or the substrate. Now the secretion of renin from the extraglomerular cells. I told you there are various stimuli which include the macular densa pathway, where whenever there is a sodium depletion, it actually happens when the BP fall, macular densa, the blood circulation to the macular densa fall, so it can eventually stimulate the renin secretion. Intrarenal baroreceptor pathway, your Bowman's capsule and all those area, the adrenergic receptor pathway. You remember that beta-1 receptors. Beta-1 receptors are there in the extraglomerular cells. Stimulation of beta-1 receptor increase the renin secretion. All right. The next component is angiotensin converting enzyme. It's also called kininase 2. Important enzyme responsible for the conversion of angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. And you know that angiotensin 2 is the potent, most active component of the renin angiotensin system. Angiotensin 2 is a potent form, we have discussed that, it's a potent vasoconstrictor and inactivates bradykinin. So angiotensin converting enzyme has got two roles. One is conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Second one, deactivation or inactivation of the bradykinin. It's a vasodilator. The principal site of its action is vascular epithelium, where it produces vasoconstriction, which one? Angiotensin 2. And angiotensin converting enzyme is produced from the vascular epithelium. And the role of or the function of ACE is inhibited by the prototype drug called captopril. It is being therapeutically used for various purposes, which includes hypertension, congestive cardiac failure, and many other indications. Angiotensin 2, next component is angiotensin 2. It has got distinct functions, which include, as I told you, act on the zona glomerulosa cells of adrenal gland and secrete the aldosterone. And you have seen what is the role of aldosterone, which increases the sodium secretion and all. So the sodium reabsorption, stimulate antidiuretic hormone from pituitary and increase the water reabsorption. Of course, the role of physiological function of ADH, you know well, increase the reabsorption of water. And it can directly act on the blood vessels, and it is one of the most potent vasoconstrictor because it acts on angiotensin receptor. And it can stimulate thirst, stimulates release of catecholamines by adrenal medulla. Angiotensin 2 can stimulate the release of catecholamines. Alright, so all these functions, see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all these functions are aimed to increase your blood pressure. See, aldosterone production, ADH secretion, vasoconstriction, stimulating thirst, catecholamine release, everything is eventually increase your blood pressure. I don't want to explain those things because it's pure physiology. You have learned the role of each components. Now, angiotensin 3 is the last component, which is not very significantly important in the renin angiotensin system. It can, to some extent, stimulate aldosterone production without vasoconstriction, but it's mild effect. It is not very much considerable. So angiotensin 2, we have seen the role of angiotensin 2, altered peripheral resistance by direct vasoconstriction, altered renal function, you've seen direct effect on increased sodium reabsorption, release of aldosterone, altered renal hemodynamics. The third one is altered cardiovascular structure, because you have seen that locally synthesized angiotensin 2, locally synthesized angiotensin 2 can stimulate the myocardium, produce ventricular hypertrophy and all. So the first mechanism, that is altered peripheral resistance or increased total peripheral resistance, leads to rapid pressure responses, vasoconstriction. The second one, altered renal functions, slower pressure response. And the third one, altered cardiovascular structure, vascular and cardiac hypertrophy and remodeling. And this is usually you've seen in chronic hypertension and also in as a compensatory mechanism in congestive cardiac failure. The details of this part shall be discussed when we discuss about congestive failure. Now, the role of angiotensin 2, we have already discussed. It's a repetition, vasoconstrictor. Increase the secretion of aldosterone. We have seen renin, angiotensinogen, convert angiotensin 2, causes cardiac and vascular hypertrophy, systemic vasoconstriction, increase blood volume by stimulating thirst, and also renal sodium and fluid retention can also lead to increase extracellular fluid and therefore blood volume. Pituitary direct effect, it can stimulate ADH, and adrenal cortex aldosterone level is increased. So all these can contribute increase blood pressure. About the renin angiotensin system. Now let's see what are the components of the pharmacological targets where it can interact or interfere with the renin angiotensin system. So one, we have already discussed that beta 1 receptors blocker, beta 1 receptor blockers, especially metoprolol. Okay, so these drugs inhibit myocardial beta 1 receptors and also inhibit the beta 1 receptors on the juxtaglomerular cells of the kidney, right? Second is a renin inhibitor. We have one drug called aliskiren. We'll be discussing that. Third one is actually those drugs which inhibit the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. So this is carried by an enzyme called angiotensin converting enzyme, carried out by ACE. So we have a group of drugs which are known as ACE inhibitors, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. And then we have next group of drugs called angiotensin receptor blockers. We will be discussing that. Okay, so these are the various targets or therapeutic targets which can be utilized in various therapeutic contexts. All right. Now, let's talk about ACE inhibitors, angiotensin converting inhibitors. So here you can see angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. Why are we talking about ACE so much? Because angiotensin 2 is the most potent form. We have seen it can act on angiotensin receptors, AT1 receptors. There are AT1 and AT2 receptors. And most of the effects of angiotensin 2 is produced by AT1. So most of the effects of renin angiotensin system is produced by angiotensin 2. That's why the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 is very important. So we are talking about angiotensin converting enzyme. And we also discussed that the breakdown of bradykinin. Bradykinin is a potent vasodilator. It can also stimulate your stretch receptor, the cuff, stretch receptors which cause cuff. And therefore, when you use ACE inhibitors in many people, it can increase the bradykinin level because it inhibits, ACE inhibitors inhibit the breakdown of bradykinin into inactive peptides. So the level of bradykinin can be increased, which in turn stimulates the cuff stretch receptors and produce dry cough. Okay, so that's also So here the path, this pathway can easily understand angiotensin. The same step, AC, angiotensin 2 is formed, act on angiotensin receptor, and stimulating angiotensin receptor produce vasoconstriction, aldosterone release, sodium retention, pro-inflammatory oxidative stress, etc., which can lead to increased blood pressure. Now, apart from this kininogen into bradykinin by caricrine, and this bradykinin is actually converted into kinin B2 receptor, act on the kinin B2 receptor, produce vasodilatation, sodium excretion, that actually blend this effect. All right. So we have AC inhibitors which block both this angiotensin 2 formation as well as bradykinin breakdown. Is that clear? I hope you are following me. Now, what happened when you block this angiotensin converting enzyme? This angiotensin 1 can be accumulated because this step is inhibited by AC inhibitor. Now, this can be accumulated and convert into an other product. Instead of forming angiotensin 2, it can divert into formation of angiotensin 1 to 7, which can act on angiotensin 1 MAS receptor and produce vasodilatation, sodium excretion, and inflammatory effect. So this is also one more advantage of using AC inhibitors. All right. Right. So what are the contraindications? One is pregnancy. We have already discussed that pregnancy, because renin angiotensin system is essential for the normal development of the renal system. Bilateral renal artery stenosis, where angiotensin 2 play a major role in the maintenance of GFR. So when you interfere or block the renin angiotensin system, so GFR may fall, and angiotensin 2 is the only mediator which maintain the GFR. So there, in bilateral renal artery stenosis, the renal system will be affected if you use AC inhibitors. So these are the two contraindications of AC inhibitors. Now here you can see bioavailabilities. Less than, most of these have less than 50% of the oral bioavailability. 8% has got 70%. So the usual dose range 4 to 32 milligram as far as candesartan is concerned. Then 20 to 40 milligram olmesartan is concerned. Okay, valsartan is 80 to 320 milligram. All right. Now the route of excretion, most of this follow kidney, and some of them with the bile also. So from the after metabolism from the liver, the fraction is actually secreted into bile. From there, it can excreted through duodenum to intestine. And telmisartan is only through the bile. Okay. So now. Fine. This is prodrug actually. Olmesartan is prodrug. You can see this. Okay. And valsartan, food can decrease the absorption. Therefore, the administration is advised to be before a food or after 2 hours of the food intake. And here, candesartan is also a prodrug. All right. Now, what are the difference between ARBs? ARB means angiotensin receptor blockers, and AC inhibitors. Definitely, there are some differences in their action. So, angiotensin receptor blockers reduce the activation of angiotensin 1 receptors. You know that it's mainly act on the angiotensin 1 receptor. So, definitely, those interaction will be blocked, and therefore, all the effects of angiotensin 2 will be blocked. And what happened? AC inhibitors actually. Which just inhibit the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2, but do not inhibit alternative non-AC angiotensin 2 generating pathway. See, when angiotensin 1 level is accumulated due to the conversion inhibition, it can undergo some other, it can take some other pathways, and finally angiotensin 2 can be so synthesized. ARB block the actions of angiotensin 2 via the AT receptors, regardless of the biochemical pathways leading to angiotensin. So absolutely, angiotensin receptor blockers can completely block whichever the pathways are operation and producing and forming angiotensin 2, no problem at all. It can be completely blocked, taken care by angiotensin 2 receptor blockers. ACE inhibitors may increase. You have seen that when you block the conversion, angiotensin 1 can be converted into angiotensin 1-2-7. ACE is involved in the clearance of angiotensin 1-7. So inhibition of ACE may increase 1-2-7 angiotensin, more so though, better than angiotensin receptor. And why are we talking about this? Because this has got an additional vasodilatory property. When angiotensin 1 is converted into other pathway, like formation of angiotensin 1-2-7, it can have an additional vasodilatory property rather than vasoconstrictive property by angiotensin 2. Is that clear? Producing such problem. So when a person, when you prefer, like usually ARBs are used for all the same condition, hypertension, left ventricular dysfunction, heart failure, congestive heart failure, then scleroderma crisis, and it is also used in all cardiovascular risk patients and immediately after myocardial infarction, whatever the indications. But now, you know, supposing the patient cannot tolerate with ACE inhibitors, like started increased incidence of cough, dry cough, then you have to switch over to ARB. And please remember that ARBs will not produce dry cough. Exactly. Now, finally, we have direct renin inhibitors. So we have tried many drugs. It's a novel class of antihypertensive drugs that inhibit renin angiotensin system at its origin. Where is the origin? All these components are activated when only renin is activated. Also, renin is completely, renin action of effect of renin on angiotensinogen is inhibited by renin inhibitor. And we have aliskiren. It's a second generation. The first generations were have tried, but due to the very the oral bioavailability of most of the first generations were very feeble and negligible. So you cannot consider through oral routes. All right. So parenteral, it will be difficult for the routine administration. So it is approved in 2007 by US FDA for the treatment of hypertension. As blood pressure lowering effects similar to those of ACE inhibitors and ARBs. So it is very important. But it's a low molecular weight, non-peptide, potent competent inhibitor of renin. This is a mechanism. It binds the active site of renin to block conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1. So the first step, angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1 will be blocked. In healthy volunteers, 40 to 640 milligram per day induces a dose-dependent decrease in blood pressure, reduces PRA and angiotensin 1 and angiotensin 2 level. So pharmacokinetics, so please remember 150 or 300 milligram per day is the recommended dose, but oral bioavailability is only 2.5%, nearly 2.5%. So if you give up to 300 milligram, the oral bioavailability is less. Plasma concentration peak will be attained within 3 to 6 hours and TRF is 20 to 45 hours. All right. Protein binding is nearly 50%. And it's substrate for P-glycoprotein. What is the importance of P-glycoprotein? It's a protein operational at the membrane, which can actively secrete out the drug. So what happened? After prolonged use, the response to aliskiren can be reduced because P-glycoprotein actively pump out the whatever aliskiren attained to the cell intracellularly. So that is one type of drug resistance can be anticipated when you use aliskiren for a long period. And minimum metabolism, rest of them directly excreted. And I told you, as far as the indication, 75 to 300 milligram is used as an antihypertensive agent. Aliskiren is an effective as ACE inhibitors. It can be combined with ACE inhibitors, ARB, hydrochlorothiazide. It's a hydrochlorothiazide is a diuretic for mild to moderate hypertension as a combination therapy. Under the study for the treatment of end organ damages, especially chronic hypertension induced end organ damages or the ventricular hypertrophy caused by prolonged congestive cardiac failure. So this is a indication. Now today with this class as a recap, we have started with the physiological role of renin angiotensin system. We also discussed we have also discuss the various components of renin-angiotensin system, its role, and then we discuss about ACE and ACE inhibitors uses, its adverse effects and contraindication, then ARBs, pharmacokinetics of ARBs like candesartan, irbesartan, telmisartan, then its uses, same as ACE inhibitors. Then finally, we discussed about the aliskiren, which is a direct renin inhibitor. So this is the basic concept of renin-angiotensin system and its pharmacology. So guys, after listening the class, if you have any doubt, you can message me in person, or you can comment in the comment box. And as your routine classes, please comment your name and roll number after listening. All right. Thank you.